Hi, this is Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day. It's not a bad day actually here at Astley Park in Chorley. I've come out to try and show you how to use close-up lenses and wide-angle adapters on the Panasonic bridge cameras like the FZ200. I'm out here today in the woods and I'm going to be shooting these wood anemones. They're quite a nice little plant and very delicate vein structure on the white petals, which makes it quite difficult to photograph. So I'm hopefully going to show you some techniques to get those details in your plant photography. I'm going to be using the FZ200. I'm going to be using an ISO 100, which is the base rate of the camera. And I always recommend you use that base ISO to give you the best picture quality you can from the camera. If you can shoot in raw format and then process that using SilkyPix or another raw processing program, and you'll get the best image quality. If you don't want to use the RAW facility, then use fine JPEG and the appropriate format for the type of application you want, either pictures or video. I tend to shoot in 16:9 as most of my pictures end up in some sort of HD video anyway. So I'm set up for ISO 100. I'm going to use the lens at its sweet spot, which is f4, and I'm going to be using my standard photo style using the +1 sharpening and -2 noise reduction, as I found that those give me the best results if I just want to shoot JPEG. First of all, I'm going to set up the camera without any close-up lenses just to shoot one bloom of this cluster. If you use the camera in its wide-angle mode, you get the natural habitat of the plant and you can see the woodland nature that this plant grows in. But I want to take some bloom pictures and I want to throw the background very nicely out of focus. So I'm going to use the camera set to its maximum telephoto, that's the 600mm position, and I'm going to move back to about a metre, which is the closest focus distance you can get in the telephoto mode. So I'm going to take the first bloom of the wood anemone and we can have a look at the background and see how nicely focused that is and some of the detail you can get using this camera. So I'm going to set up for that first shot now. So I'm about a metre away. I'm going to use maximum telephoto, so that shoots out to the full extent of the lens. I'm going to use ISO 100, my standard photo style, and +1 sharpening, -2 noise reduction. I've got the focus set to single area, and I'm using the focus button on the side of the camera to set the smallest size so I can actually focus directly on the bloom and not the background. And I'm going to take the first picture at f4 using the 2-second remote timer. The calculated exposure is 1/400th of a second, which should be sufficient to stop the slight amount of shake coming from the wind. So I'm now going to take the first picture and we can have a look at the background, which is neatly defocused. At the moment I'm using the cloudy white balance setting just to warm the scene up, but there's the sun shining. I'm just going to back that off to the daylight mode just to cool that down a little bit. And I'll take the second shot. Right. As this is a white subject, I'm going to try and put a little bit of negative EV compensation in there so that I don't overexpose the highlights and lose all those detail. So I'm going to dial in about -2/3 of an EV. So depressing the rear button on the camera to access the EV control, and I'm dialing in 2/3 of an EV minus. And again, I'll take that shot. And that looks to have shown a little bit more detail. If I move further back, then obviously the size of the bloom will actually decrease. And to get the best image quality, you always need to be filling the frame with your subject. This is the closest we can get with the FZ200 with the native lens. But I want to show you today a method of decreasing that minimum working distance by use of close-up lenses. The ones I'll recommend are the 52mm threaded type, and they're screwed directly onto the lens itself. Panasonic recommend you use the LA55 tube and the 55mm close-up lens. If you use that conversion tube, you need to set the conversion mode of the camera, so that limits the zoom from ×4 to ×24, as using that actual converter tube gives you vignetting around the outside edge if you don't use ×4 zoom as a minimum. But I can recommend you use just ordinary 52mm threaded filters, as they don't add much weight to the lens and you aren't going to destroy the zoom motor in that mode. I recommend you use the plus one and the plus two close-up lenses, as they give you the opportunity to move to about 18 inches and 12 inches respectively, and you can get some nice pictures. If you go to the plus four or the plus 10, you do get a lot of chromatic aberration, that's color fringing around the outside of highlights, and you get a lot of edge distortion. The more you pay for these lenses, the better quality you'll get. You can pay up to £20 per lens, but I have seen sets of three, four, just £12 on eBay or Amazon. But I guess you'll get what you pay for, so I would recommend you get the best quality you can. I have a series of close-up lenses here, 52mm, 58mm and 62mm, just because of the number of lenses that I use with my DSLR and my Micro Four Thirds system cameras. So I'm going to give them all a whirl, just for my own interest, to see if there's any difference in definition or outside chromatic aberration by using a larger filter on the 52mm thread of the FZ200. So I'm now going to set up using the plus one lens, and we'll see how close I can get with that facility. So I'll remove the lens head, and I'm going to screw in place the number one lens. So it just screws into the front element of the lens, and from experience I know that I can come down to about 18 inches, to give me a full size image. Right, now I'm actually filling 3/4 of the screen with that same bloom, and I'll take the first shot to show you that result. So we're seeing the use of the number one and the number two close-up lenses to reduce the minimum working distance of the camera in its telephoto mode. It's ideal if you want to shoot things like butterflies or insects. You can then move away from the subject and not disturb them. If you're trying to get close using just the ordinary wide-angle position, you'll probably find that the butterfly will fly off before you got your shot. But by using a number one or number two close-up lens, you can be about 18 inches or 2 feet away, still get the same magnification on the sensor, and get some good images. I'm now going to change over from the 52mm thread to the 58, followed by the 62mm thread filters, just to see if there's any difference in quality between the two filter types. So that first shot after the number two close-up is with the number one 62mm thread, which is larger than the 52mm thread that I need for this camera, but again I just wanted to see the amount of detail using this filter, is whether it's better than the standard 52mm ones that I have. So I'll take another shot as the wind has started to get up again. I'll now switch to the number two filter, as the number two filter tends to be the one that gives you a lot more chromatic aberration. As these lenses aren't specifically matched to Panasonic's optics, you always get some sort of distortion around the outside edges. And the poorer the quality of the filter, the actual manifest is a lot more chromatic aberration. So let's see how this one fares with the number two close-up lens. I have a number four filter here in my bag, and I'm just going to show you the result of using a number four, which does tend to give you a lot more chromatic aberration. So this is a number four filter, or close-up lens, and it reduces the working distance even more, so I'm going to move closer into the bloom. And this is now filling the screen with just the stamens of the plant. Obviously because of the magnification, the image is moving around quite a lot, but I'm hoping the camera can capture that with the 800th of a second exposure. Depth of field is very shallow using the number four lens, so again I'm going to try to move up to f8 to try and capture a little bit more depth of field, but that does extend the shutter time, which may result in a lot more image movement. and I can see around the outside edge, there is a lot more chromatic aberration. So I wouldn't normally recommend you use the +4 under these situations. It does give you a lot of image degradation, but if you can manage with the central area and crop out the unwanted bits, you might be able to get away with some of these images. Quite often you can't isolate a bloom against its background because you can't get far enough away, and in that situation you can use coloured card. I'll carry a pack of coloured cards in my bag, and dependent on the type of subject, you probably use a complementary colour behind the subject. So you can put your card behind the scene, take the shot, and then you've got a nice contrasted background to the photograph that you're taking. So you use a complementary colour, so for example with yellow daffodils, you might want to use a blue card behind. Here's some examples of the blue and green card that I've been using, just to give you an idea of how that looks. Another useful accessory to carry in your camera bag if you're a plant photographer is a small nylon diffuser. You can use this to give you a nice soft light on the subject if you find that the highlights are burning out. So I'll set up this shot so that I can use the diffuser to soften the light that's falling on that wooden enemy and see if we can get a better rendition. So now I'm going to use this to provide the soft light on the anemone, making sure that I'm not actually in shot myself. And that's the shot with the diffuser. You can also use this diffuser or reflector to throw light back into the subject if you find you've got some heavy shadows in there, and you can use a bounce light to soften those shadows. Now I'm going to show you the use of wide-angle adapters. It's quite a frequent question I get asked on the channel, can you use wide-angle adapters with the bridge cameras? Obviously Panasonic would prefer you not to use wide-angle adapters directly onto the lens because of the possibility of damage to the zoom motor. So what I would recommend is that you turn off the things like economy, which prevents the camera from going to sleep, and then you can attach the lens once the camera's been powered up, take your shot, then remove the converter before the camera powers down. That way you're not using the zoom motor, and you're probably going to get some wide angle shots without any damage to your camera. So that's how I've got the camera set up at the moment, with the economy set to about 5 minutes. So the first shot I'm going to take is the wide angle setting with the lens, just to show the natural habitat of these wooden enemies, and including some of the background. So I'll just recompose the shot, take it on 2 second timer, and that's the ambience of this scene. The first adapter I'm going to install is one by Nua. They obviously distribute it from China, and this is a 0.45 conversion lens. So you're going to multiply the focal length of the lens by 0.45, so the native 25mm becomes something like a 12mm lens. Unfortunately, because of this size of optic, you do get some vignetting. And if I take the first picture, you'll see that there's a vignetting in the 16:9 format, and it's going to be even worse if you switch to a 4:3 format. So I'll take the first picture, and you can see the amount of vignetting. To overcome that, obviously, you can crop away that in your post-production, or I'm just going to zoom in slightly until that vignetting goes away. We've still got more wide-angle coverage than with the standard lens, but again, you can see that the outside edge is tending to be a little bit soft and showing a little bit of chromatic aberration on the tree branches in the background. So it's a budget lens, and it's a budget result that you'll get. I'm now going to switch over to a slightly more expensive lens. It's got a larger outside diameter, which means that it doesn't vignette. It hasn't got the same magnification as the other one. This is a 0.7 times, so we're not going to get the super wide angle of 12mm. We're going to get something like a 16 or 17mm lens. We'll screw that into position, and I can zoom right out again because I don't get any vignetting with this lens. And again, I'll take that picture just to show you the amount of coverage you get using that lens. So that's the Digital King 0.7x wide angle converter. So those are some of the options you can use if you want to be out filming plants and animals, using your wide angle lens to set the ambient nature of the scene, and then use your telephoto and, if necessary, a close-up lens to be able to throw those blooms nicely out of focus. Here's a sample of shots I've taken today of some daffodils and crocus and tulips in and around the park, just to show you the type of pictures you can get using the telephoto setting at 1 meter away and with some close-up lenses. Well, that's it for this video. Thanks very much for watching. And of course, if you don't already subscribe to this channel, please consider doing so, as you will be then notified when I upload new videos. So until the next video, it's Graham saying thanks for watching and bye for now.